University of Santo Tomas political science professor Dennis Coronacion now joins us for his assessment of the president's fifth State of the Nation address. Thank you so much for joining us, Professor Coronacion, and good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Rain. Thank you for having me here.
Your reaction to the SONA, Professor. What for you were the more contentious assertions by the president?
Well, I think there are some things that, the people are really talking about at the moment. So one of the things that he mentioned is that he would like to push through with his plan of enacting the death penalty law. Well, if he would, if that would push through, I'm sure that a lot of quarters, especially from the conservative side, are going to disagree with the proposed bill. Now, let me go to the, some of the other matters that the address, the president's address had covered. He expressed gratitude to the frontliners and private companies for their selfless contributions. He also proposed solutions to the negative effects on the economy and public health caused by the pandemic, such as in education and the Bayanihan Law 2. And then he also clarified his stand on national issues such as the ABS-CBN shutdown, the issue on oligarchy, and the South China Sea issue. He also called for unity among the people. But I found it odd that the president is calling for unity. At the opening of his address, he criticized Senate President Drilon, and towards the end of his address, he also did the same thing. So that's really, I think, contradictory. And then he also sent a message of hope. He's trying to inspire the people that despite the adversities that we're going through, he's trying to show that the president is doing something. And then he also tried to show leadership. Through his programs and proposed bills, he would like the public to see to it that that he is still in charge. Despite all the criticisms and despite all the adversities. Mm-hmm. So those are, I think, the highlights of the president's address.
For you, and let's go through some of your points one by one. His COVID plans, I think a lot of people were really expecting that it would touch on some of the priorities or lay out some of the plans. And he was saying that he prioritized lives over quickly reopening the economy. He also mentioned the CREATE bill and the Advanced Nursing Learning Act, asking banks also for interest-free loans, and threatening the telcos on improving their services at the threat of expropriation. Him also saying that government response to the virus had saved millions of lives. Do you think that this is the extent of his COVID response, and how would you rate it?
Well, I think this is what the president can do. Well, he has been trying to strike a balance between giving priority to public health and the economic problems caused by the pandemic. It is quite obvious that the president is tilting towards improving the economy, since he knew for a fact that without revitalizing the economy, it would be very difficult on the part of the government to gather funds for his for his COVID-19 programs. So I think that has been his dilemma ever since, how to strike a balance between the economy and public health.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Him saying China has physical possession of Philippine territories in an appeal to get priority in case of a vaccine, saying he's inutile when it comes to this political stand on territories. He talks about some parties taking advantage of the government's distraction with the virus, but at the same time, hasn't China also done so, and haven't our legislators also been able to pass bills that are not COVID-related?
Well, yes, it's quite disappointing that the president has again reiterated his self-defeatist policy or stand regarding the South China Sea issue. We have been hearing this from him ever since he got elected, that he has already given up on, you know, on our claim on this, on certain parts of West Philippine Sea. So we thought that the president would not talk about his foreign policy stand anymore, particularly with regard to that to West Philippine Sea. But then again, you know, just as when everyone thought that that this wasn't relevant at all, he, you know, he had managed to find time to discuss this, which goes to show that the president is really, a bit distracted when it comes to focusing on finding the right solutions to the pandemic. He, you know, he had managed to squeeze in, political issues, or should we say, politicking, by discussing or including those topics in his address. Mm-hmm.
He said that the armed forces will also play a crucial role in governance, and his continued push for the war on drugs, saying freedom and drugs and freedom from drugs and criminality are a human right. What do you make of these?
I think that's the president's comfort zone. Whenever he would, in the past few years, whenever he would deliver his SONA, he would always talk about the war on drugs, even though I think as time went by, especially under the special, under the circumstances, I don't think that drugs poses as the number one menace to our society. I think it's more of the virus. So again, I think it's the president showing going back to his comfort zone. Now, as for the importance that he has given to the role of the military, I think almost everyone in the academe agree on the fact that giving so much importance on the military as part of the solution to the pandemic, the president has increased the so-called militarization of what is supposed to be a health crisis. So I mean, there's a mismatch between the solution that has been offered by the president and the problem at hand. So it has given way to the securitization of what should have been a health problem.
Well, his criticism of an opposition senator on the issue of political dynasty, while he continued to attack oligarchs, saying this president who won the elections is a casualty. Do you find that ironic?
Well, yes, he would like to portray himself as a casualty of ABS-CBN back in 2016 when he was still campaigning for the presidency. But I really find it ironic in so many respects. First of all, he was trying to ask everyone to stand together and to unite to fight the pandemic. And yet we hear him rant against Senator Drilon. So why would he call for unity when he seems to be in a combative mood? Another thing is that if you're going to shut down, if you're going to say that your intention is to dismantle the oligarchy, I think the more serious and the more effective solution is not to shut down a media company owned by a certain family, but to encourage Congress to pass an anti-dynasty law. It was a perfect opportunity for him to, you know, to realize his dream. If ever he's serious of dismantling the oligarchy in this country, yesterday would have been a perfect opportunity for him to initiate to realize that dream by encouraging Congress to pass the anti-dynasty law.
What do you think the public, Professor, wanted to know in this penultimate State of the Nation address? What do you feel the last 2 years of the president should accomplish?
Well, the last 2 years should be an opportunity for the president to build his legacy. So his promises, his campaign promises since 2016, especially the major promises that he gave to the that he gave us, he should really exert extraordinary effort to realize all these promises. Say, for example, I just learned that the build program is the target has not yet been reached, and it has been underperforming in terms of hitting the target, and that would have been a good legacy for the president, since he would have been the only Philippine president that came up with such an ambitious infrastructure plan. And then another thing would have been rebuilding the economy. That's one of his promises too, but all we heard from the president are just perhaps you could say that a framework, he had given us a framework, but the details are still wanting. And then another thing that the public, I think, is really wanted to hear from the president is whether or not the government has been doing anything in looking for a vaccine. We did not hear that yesterday, but it's something that the government should have, or that the president should have said in his address. At what point are we in looking for a treatment, for a vaccine to the coronavirus? So I of course, we all know that China, US, and even the United Kingdom have already done big steps in looking for a treatment or a vaccine. They have signed contracts with pharmaceutical companies. So my question is, ginawa na ba natin to? Have we done this? Kasi wala naman sinabi ang presidente tungkol dito.
Right. He did mention that he sought a commitment from China that we would get priority once China came up with a vaccine, although some public health reform advocates warned about that, saying that China has never been considered the go-to for such vaccines, and he would rather that we consider or talk to pharmaceutical companies or even countries like the UK, Australia, or the European countries. Now, what about, should we talk about the peripherals of the State of the Nation address? Of course, austerity seemed to be a theme. The production before it was that needed. The limited physical guest list, the lack of fanfare.
Excuse me, sorry.
Should we talk about all the extraneous things about this, the State of the Nation address this year? Of course, the guest list was limited. There was a lot of testing before that, as well as there was a lack of fanfare. Plus, was a director needed? Was a production really needed for such an event?
Of course, all these preparations were done as part of the precautionary measures of the government to prevent the spread of the virus during the address. But one thing is certainly lacking yesterday. If there's something that was certainly lacking, it was the the usual fashion show, I suppose. And of course, the public would always be excited to see what kinds of clothes our congressmen and our senators are wearing every time there would be a SONA. When it comes to the mood, yesterday, I think the president was in a somber mood, which was really quite appropriate. So he tried to be less funny, but he really could not help it but to give, his usual off the cuff remarks. If I'm not mistaken, his threat that was issued to Globe and Smart to improve their services I think was not part of the address, the president's script. So those are my observations.
Mm-hmm. And don't you think that these off-the-cuff remarks are actually things that could affect investor confidence in the country?
No, I don't think so. Of course, the only intention of the president when he said that particular remark on Smart and Globe is to improve the services. So he was probably thinking of the public welfare and the welfare of the consumers. But I don't think it could, you know, send jitters to the investors. And then, of course, his threats to expropriate public utilities. I think his only intention there is to shape up, for them to shape up and to avoid practices that could be detrimental to the public.
University of Santo Tomas political science professor Dennis Coronacion, thank you so much for weighing in on the issue with us. We appreciate that you're there. Thank you.
Thank you.